privilege to be with you tonight. And I've got the tissues up here because I'm probably going to cry. I almost cried when Cheryl was just introducing me, but I'm just so grateful. I know so many of you. And it's just such a privilege to be here tonight and just to share with you. And I'm just going to be real. I'm going to be open. I'm going to be honest. If you need to cry, please cry with me, okay? But this is such a happy, happy story. And I cry because I'm grateful. And I'm not going to cry the whole time, okay? So don't worry. But pull it down. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm kind of loud anyway. So I was a teacher. And I taught I see a lot of moms that I taught their precious children. And that is such a privilege and an honor. But my name is Cynthia McGuire. I grew up here in Oklahoma, out in the panhandle of Oklahoma. So life out there is totally different than it is here in the city. You know, my dad says I'm a city girl now, but I grew up out on the farm, working cattle, driving the tractor, being a farmer's daughter, and have six sisters and one brother. And just grew up out on the farm, a little Christian girl loving Jesus. My parents would take us to church every week, you know. And just a little dreamer. You know, I brought my journal and I'm going to use it, but I have all my pictures on the outside, on the inside. I'm a dreamer still today. You know, I've got all the things. This is my wedding dreaming journal here. Driving the tractor, 15 years old, and just crying out to the Lord, you know, saying, God, I just want your will in my life. I just want, you know, everything that you have for me. And, you know, I just want to love people and I want to love you more. And I want to marry an amazing man of God and I want to minister for you. And, you know, just crying out in my little 15-year-old heart, just loving Jesus with all my heart. And God brought my sisters and I to a church camp here in Tulsa at Oral Roberts University called Youth America. And when we came that summer, it was like, you know, I had an encounter with the God of the universe. I went up to the altar and got prayer, and it was kind of like one of these iRefresh prayer meetings. It's like when you leave tonight, you're going to know that the God of the universe hears your prayer and he speaks to you and he's here to touch you tonight. And so the word that the Lord gave me that night when I was 17, actually, God told me, you know, your husband is going to find you. He's going to be bigger than you, not only physically, but spiritually. And he will find you. You're not going to have to look for him. Well, my little 17-year-old excited heart, you know, I'm thinking, okay, woo, I'm going to go to college. I know I'm going to meet him at ORU. And I see some of my friends from ORU, some of my girls, we all graduated around the same time. But, you know, I thought for sure I'm going to meet him at ORU, you know. And my heart, you know, I've always desired to be a mom. Always, always desired to be married. I'm sorry I'm crying because I'm so happy. And, you know, it's been a long wait. God spoke to me when I was 17, that dream, and he gave me that desire. And when I was a little girl, I used to play dolls with my sisters. We used to pretend like we were having babies, you know, all the way back then, you know. And anyways, went to ORU. I didn't see him. Any guy that was taller than me, I was like, oh my gosh, is that him? Maybe that's him, you know. Oh, he's lifting his hands in worship. He's taller than me. Maybe that's him, you know. And, you know, didn't meet him at college. So I thought, okay, surely I'm going to go. I felt God lead me across the street to Victory to teach school. And I thought, well, okay, I thought I was going to get married. But, you know, here I am 22. If I have to start working, then, okay, teaching school. I know I'm called to teach school. And, you know, I thought, surely I'll meet him here. Well, during that whole season, I realized teaching school is full-time ministry. If you don't know, teachers are full-time ministers and just mothers, and they get to disciple children. So it was a 12-year season of just an amazing season in my life, you know, just loving on other people's children and raising them up to hear God's voice like Cheryl was talking about. But honestly, I didn't know that was going to be a 12-year season. I thought, okay, I'll teach school here for 1 year, 2 years, and then I'll be getting married and going off and doing my ministry and, you know, all the things that I could see in the spirit. And, you know, I just had to stay faithful where God put me. He put me at Victory. He put me at Victory Christian School. And, you know, I would, sometimes I'd go out on dates with guys, you know, and I just, okay, he's nice. He's, you know, he's cute, but he doesn't really love Jesus like I do. Or, oh, he really loves Jesus, but I don't know if I'm attracted to him, or he's way shorter than me. And I don't know about you, but if you're a tall girl, you really do. Most tall girls want somebody taller than them. It's just, you know, you don't want to feel like the big girl. And maybe you have to be 6 foot to feel like that. I don't know. That's how tall I am. But, and when I wear shoes, I'm like 6 foot three. But anyways, you know, just stayed faithful, loving those kids, and surrounded myself with godly friends like you all have here that could pray for you when you feel like I'm about to give up, I'm about to let go of this dream, I'm about to drop this word that God gave me because I'm not seeing anything. You know, sometimes you don't see anything in the natural, but you know things are happening in the spirit. And so just kept pressing through teaching school. And finally, every summer I would say, people would say, are you going to be teaching school next year? And I'd say, well, unless God opens up the door for something else. And, you know, in my heart, I knew what that meant. You know, I was hoping, okay, maybe I'll meet my husband, get married, do something different. But, you know, finally, after 12 years, I felt the release to stop teaching school. And I honestly did not know what I was going to do next. And so I just said, hey, I just feel like the Holy Spirit's saying this is time. It's time to resign after 12 years. And I resigned, and they, you know, we cried and hugged and loved the school so much, loved all the parents, loved the children, but I just knew that it was time for me to step out and God had something else. Well, God did have something else. And in fact, I went to VBI full time for a full quarter, didn't have any job, didn't know what to do, you know, just trusting God, stepped out in faith. And then he opened the door for me to become the single women's pastor at Victory. And so for the past 3 years, I've been on the pastoral staff at Victory Christian Center, and I've been able to minister to the single women of our church and really just encouraging them to stay in their race until, you know, just keep pressing through with endurance, and God's going to, you know, bring the reward. Well, I have actually, you know, just in this past year and a half, my miracle, my, you know, word from God has come true. And I don't want to forget anything. Let me open this up real quick. You know, it was a 20-year wait for me, and I do not wish that on anybody, you know. But whatever promise God gives you, you know, you have to stand in faith on his word, and you have to believe, and you have to surround yourself with godly friends that are going to cheer you on in your race that you're running. And let me tell you, about 2 years ago, when I came to this place, iRefresh, I was on that couch, and I was at a point, you know, we all come to that place sometimes when you just feel like you can't hardly run your race anymore. Christine knows. And you're just running your race as hard as you can, and you feel like, Lord, I can't do this anymore. You know, when am I going to see the fulfillment of what you've spoken in my life? And it was there on that couch that these godly women surrounded me. And it was like the Holy Spirit breathed life into me. It was like he breathed breath into me to be able to continue to run my race strong, and not only run it, but enjoy it. It was like the last 2 years of ministry as a pastor have just been so enjoyable, so joyful. You know, it wasn't a sad time. It's been just great joy, and just being able to pour into these other women and encourage them and just speak into their lives as I have had been spoken into as well. So I actually waited 20 years. When I was 37, I was introduced to Mark Murphy. Now, he is my fiance now. There was a group of women from my church, Victory Christian Center, that went on missions over to Ireland. The church they went to was Victory in Dublin, Ireland. And one of the ladies on the trip, she said when she saw this guy, and he was like doing all this stuff in the church and walking around, and, you know, she said when she saw him, she said, Cynthia McGuire. And so, you know, they came back from the missions trip and they said, hey, Cynthia, we saw this gorgeous guy in Ireland. I mean, one of the ladies was like, I think he's taller than you. He might be taller than you. I think he's taller than you. But, you know, we told him all about you. He says you sound nice. And I said, well, you know, he sounds nice. Okay. Well, I said, tell him he can be my friend on Facebook. You know, and I honestly thought nothing is ever going to happen. He lives in Dublin, Ireland. I'm from Slabbot, Oklahoma. I live in Tulsa. You know, I thought, okay, we can be Facebook friends, you know. And he actually waited 6 months because he prayed about it. He prayed about even Facebook friending me, which to me, like now I just think, wow, what a man, you know? And he finally, when he felt the release, he Facebook friended me. And so of course I said yes. And we started talking on Facebook as friends, and you know, he just led our relationship, just such a mighty man of integrity. He said, you know, this is so much fun talking over Facebook, but can I give you a call? You know, and I said, sure. So he got my number, and then we heard each other on the phone, you know, for the first time. Hi, how are you? You know, I'm like, wow, listen to that accent. You know, he's from Ireland, and he's full-blood Irish, you know, so he has that great accent. And
talking on the phone. He said, this is great talking on the phone, you know, but can we Skype face-to-face over the computer? And I said, wonderful. Yes, I'd love to. So we started Skyping face-to-face on the computer and just came to know each other as great friends. He just was a mighty man of God. It was like we were living similar lives, but the ocean apart, you know. He was in his church ministering, helping with pastoring, helping do whatever they needed to do, you know, just serving and serving and serving. He'd been serving this church for about 9 years, you know, and so there was a group of people in his church that just knew him and loved him. He was, you know, he's just like a beloved member of their church. And so we Skyped face to face and he was like, hey, this is great, but can I come over and see you and meet you face to face? And by that time I said, yes, absolutely. You know, I was ready to meet him face to face. Well, you know, that first meeting at the airport was so fun in Tulsa Airport. God is so sweet. He like cleared I didn't know anybody, which is a miracle in Tulsa because I know a ton of people, but I said, God, please don't let me see anybody I know. Cause I just don't want to, you know, I don't know what this is going to be like. I don't know if we're going to have a connection face to face. You know, how we were getting to know each other was through the Holy Spirit. Honestly, it was just this friendship, this Holy Spirit connection as we would talk and pray. And he initiated, hey, let's pray together. I mean, he was just such an amazing leader in the whole process. But anyways, when we met face to face, I mean, it was just like, oh my gosh, wow. It was like icing on the cake. I was like, whoa. I was like, you're taller than me. Oh my gosh. Ah! And I know I did jump up and down. I really did because I get crazy excited about stuff sometimes. But I was like, ah, you're taller than me. And he was like, oh my gosh, you're beautiful. I was like, you're so handsome. And we were just like, we were like in love from like first sight, you know, because we'd already gotten to know each other through the Spirit. And it was just amazing. So we had, you know, just a wonderful time hanging out here in Tulsa. My in Tulsa parents, you know, got to know him. Then I took him out to the farm. My parents out there in Slapaw got to know him. They just loved him. My whole family got to meet him that first trip when he was out here. We just had an amazing time just getting to know each other and just hanging out. And then it just progressed. We both, honestly, after that first meeting face to face, we both knew. And I always knew that it would be a suddenly, I'm 38, and I knew that, you know, God had been preparing me all my life for, you know, for marriage, for children, and in the meantime, though, doing ministry and running my race. And so I knew it was going to be a quick work that God was going to do. And so, you know, when we met each other and it was like instant connection, we were both so excited. He was like, well, I'm going to go home and start making preparations. And I said, okay, awesome. And so the next thing I knew, I said, okay, yay. Next thing I knew, he was calling my dad, calling my mom, asking them for permission to marry me. And he said, I wouldn't want to do it without your blessing, but I would love to. It's my intention that when Cynthia comes to Ireland, which he said, the next step is for me to bring you over here to meet my friends and my family, which is that's what he did. And he said, he asked my parents, he said, it's my intention to ask Cynthia to marry me. And my parents said, yes, you know, we love you. We can see that you guys are the perfect match for each other. We know that you are what she's waited for all this time. And so when I went over to Ireland then this past August, you know, just had a whirlwind, like romantic tour, stayed with his mom and dad. They're just so precious and met all his friends and family at church. And he took me to this castle called Kilkenny Castle, and I thought we were just going to go tour the castle. So I'm standing in line, you know, thinking, okay, I'm so excited. The castles, you know, yes, I'm from Oklahoma. And I was like, so all about the history. And I'm like, this is a Jane Austen movie. I'm like, this is gorgeous. I just felt like I was living in Pride and Prejudice, you know, it was just beautiful. And excuse me. So I was standing in line. I didn't know what was going to happen. You know, I was in my shorts and tennis shoes and sweater. And so he said, sweetie, let's go out to the Rose Garden. I think something's going to happen out here at 3:00. And I go, okay, well, you know, I was thinking I'm almost in line here to get our ticket, you know, but okay, let's go out to the Rose Garden. So I went out back to the Rose Garden and we were looking around and I was like, sweetie, let's smell the roses. Oh my gosh. So I was like leaning down. I'm like smelling the roses. And he's like, yeah, that's beautiful. But come up here. Something's going to happen up here at 3:00. Well, at 3:00, he got down on one knee at that castle and asked me to marry him in front of all the tourists, and everybody was clapping, and it was just so beautiful and so magical and just so holy. And of course, I said yes. And I'm just so expectant at all God's got for us, but that's not the end of the story. You know, sometimes people didn't understand, honestly. They didn't understand, okay, Cynthia, you know, you're a pretty girl. Why are you single? Or, you know, you're 25, now you're 35. What's going on? You know, why don't you just like go out on dates? And I was like, well, I do, I'm open. It's not that. It's just that I haven't met the right one. You know, I'm waiting on the one that I feel is from God. And, you know, I told the single girls when I ministered to them, the one thing that was different about this relationship than any other one is, you know, I've been out on dates with guys. I went out with this one guy for a month. I thought he was almost the right one. Gorgeous, 6'5", big muscles, blue eyes, you know, love Jesus, but not quite there yet. Not quite exactly a stronger than me fit in the spirit. And, you know, honestly, I told the girls, I felt sick to my stomach. that's the Holy Spirit's way of saying something's not quite right here. And so I just had like this little bit of an ickiness in my stomach, like the whole time we would hang out and everything, even though it looked right, it wasn't right. And I'm so thankful the Holy Spirit gives us that, you know, unrest sometimes, because now that I'm in this relationship with Mark, it's been nothing but peace. It's been nothing but joy. I mean, you know, for me, I'm so close to my family. For me to leave my parents, to leave Victory, which I've been working there for 16 years, for me just to uproot myself and move to Ireland, it can be nothing but God, you know, because I'm like a close family type person. But I've had nothing but peace and joy and rest. And just talking a little bit about the persecution sometimes that you get waiting for God's best or waiting for the fulfillment of a promise. Sometimes people don't understand. They just don't get it. You know, one time when I was like 25, my cousin was like, Cynthia, what's wrong with you? Are you a lesbian? You know, and I was like, I mean, the devil will use anything he can to try to steal your dreams, to try to break your heart. You know, I said, of course not. And people were like, what's wrong with you? Or what's wrong with guys around you? What, you know, and it's just, I had a promise. I just was waiting on a promise of God to come true. And, you know, even my family was so supportive, but sometimes my grandpa would tease me, and he's in heaven now, so I can tell this story, but he used to always tease me, and, you know, I'd come home for Christmas, Grandpa, you know, and he'd be like, well, how's my old maid school teacher? You know, I'd be like, Grandpa, I rebuke that in Jesus' name. I'm not going to be an old maid school teacher, you know? And, but he would always tease me and say, you know, if you can't get a red bird, a blue bird will do. Kind of teasing me like, well, just go ahead and just get a blue bird, you know? You can't get a red bird, so just take any bird, you know? And, I was like, Grandpa, I'm waiting on God's best, okay? I'm waiting on God's best. And so you're going to see in the video in just a few minutes a picture of me at the end of the video, and I'm actually crying, but it is, my cousin gave this to me a few years ago, and it was for my birthday. And when I saw it, I just started crying because it was just reminding me of the hope that I was holding in my heart. I hadn't met Mark then, but I was waiting for my red bird. I was waiting for God's best in my life. And then for my wedding present, she gave me the little matching red bird because God has done the miracle in my life, and waiting for his best is possible. And I am getting my red bird, Grandpa. But we have a special gift for all of you, even if you're not single. We would love for you to take one of these and even bless, if you have a single friend, or even if you're believing for something from God, we want to share this with you. It says, as I got older and was waiting to meet the right guy, my grandpa used to tease me by saying, if you can't get a red bird, a blue bird will do. I know he sees from heaven that God has blessed me with a red bird, his best. God's got his best for you too. This bracelet is a gift from the Single Women's Ministry, reminding you to never forget that you are worth the wait and will receive God's best.
That is all in my life. heroes rise, heroes fall, rise again. We need all
in your heart. Can't you feel the glory? Move our heart without pain. We can move worlds again. Take my hand, dance with me. I want to spend my lifetime with you. And that is all in life forevermore. I will want the feelings to see you. If I can spend
just so thankful. I mean, I cry every time I see the video because I'm living that. I mean, it is my dream come true. And the verse at the beginning was Proverbs 13:12. And it talks about hope deferred makes the heart sick. And I walked through that for a while. But the second part of that verse is, but when dreams come true at last, there's life and joy. And I know some of you in this room have promises from God that you're believing for. It might be children. It might be your own children. It might be just whatever the Lord. Some of you may be single and believing for a spouse as well. Whatever promise God's given you, He is faithful to bring it to pass. He who speaks, He promises and He fulfills. And He's the one that performs those things on our behalf and works those things out for good. And I just wanted to share a scripture with you. A couple of scriptures real quick. Romans 4:17 through 25 in the Message translation says, "We call Abraham father, not because he got God's attention by living like a saint, but because God made something out of Abraham when he was a nobody." Isn't that what we've always read in scripture? God saying to Abraham, "I set you up as a father of many peoples." And I always circle that, "I set you up." God has set each one of us up for great things. He has already prepared and set up things in our lives for us to walk into. And it says, Abraham was first named father, and then he became a father because he dared to trust God to do what only God could do. And I want to ask you tonight, what are you daring to trust God to do that only God can do in your life? What are you daring to trust God to do that only He can do? And if you're not daring to believe Him in something that would seem impossible, I encourage you, start believing Him for something impossible. Start believing for something that only He could do. And it says, what God did was raise the dead to life, and with a word make something out of nothing. And I feel like tonight, some of you ladies, you may have dreams. You may have some things in your heart that God needs to raise to life again, just like He did right here on this couch in my life, you know. He is going to raise some things to life again, some dreams and some hopes and some desires. And it says, God Himself said to Abraham, "You're going to have a big family, Abraham." Abraham didn't focus on himself or his
his impotence, or he didn't say it's hopeless. This 100-year-old body could never father a child. He didn't survey Sarah's decades of infertility and give up. He didn't tiptoe around God's promise, asking cautiously skeptical questions. This is what Abraham did, and this is what we need to do. He pressed, he plunged into God's promise and came up strong, ready for God, sure that God would make good on what he had said. That is why it said Abraham was declared fit before God, trusting God to set him right. And I want to encourage you tonight, whatever promise you're believing God for, whatever you are daring to trust God to do in your life, press into him tonight. That's why you're here. You're hungry. You're here to press into him tonight. And whatever you're pressing, when you press into God, Isaiah 62:9 says, whatever you press, let me read it to you real quick. Isaiah 62:9 says, within the temple courts, you yourself shall drink the wine you press. So even as tonight, as you press in for more of God, you're going to drink the fruit of that. Whatever we press past, just like that woman with the issue of blood, she had a promise. She was going to get healed if she touched Jesus. You know, so she pressed past everybody else to get to Jesus. And sometimes you have to press back people. It doesn't matter what it looks like. It doesn't matter if you cry on the couch in front of all your friends. You know, you do what you need to do to press in, to plunge into that promise, and to drink the fruit of that, to drink the wine that you press. That's what God's promise to you is. Hebrews 10:35-39 in the Amplified Bible says, do not therefore fling away your fearless confidence, for it carries a great and glorious compensation of reward. And I want to stir you up tonight. Whatever you are believing God for, you can believe him with fearless confidence. God is a God that does not lie. You can trust him. You can have fearless confidence in him tonight. It says you will have a glorious compensation of reward, for you have need of steadfast patience and endurance. And I believe that the Lord is going to impart that into you tonight. You're going to receive more endurance like I received right here on this couch. I received fresh breath to run my race. I felt like I was about to drop out of my race, but I received just a fresh grace and a fresh breath of God just to finish my race strong and to enjoy it and to have fun and to notice the other women on the race with me. It wasn't just about me and my race and looking down and not seeing anyone else. It was about seeing the other women around me on this race and saying, come on, girl, come on, you can do it. You can do it. Don't give up. Let's run this race together. And I think that's what iRefresh is all about. It's such a beautiful ministry. You know, you get refreshed from the Lord. When Cheryl was talking, I was just thinking, yeah, I received refreshing here, but you know what? Now I go out and I refresh others. You know, what a privilege, what an opportunity. And that's how it's supposed to be. And it says, the just shall live by faith. We don't live by our feelings, our emotions, but we live by faith. We don't draw back or shrink in fear because God's soul has no delight or pleasure in him. Our way is not of those who draw back into eternal misery, but we are of those who believe and by faith preserve the soul. So I want to encourage you tonight, for those of you who, you know, you've got a promise from God. What do you do between the promise and the fulfillment of that promise? Well, mine was a 20-year press. You know, first thing you do, you press. You press into Jesus, just like you're doing here tonight. I can feel the hunger in each of you for more of God, more of the Holy Spirit. So even tonight, as you're here, it just shows that you're pressing through Christmas responsibilities. You're pressing through stress. You're pressing through whatever is trying to hold you back, and you're pressing into more of God. And you, the next thing you need to do is praise. Hebrews 13:15 says, through him, let us continually at all times offer up to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of our lips that thankfully acknowledge and confess and glorify his name. You know, sometimes we don't feel like praising. Sometimes you don't feel like praising, but you offer that sacrifice of praise. So many times I would jump up and down during praise and worship. You know, I didn't have my husband. I didn't even have a ring on my finger. I didn't even have a boyfriend. It didn't look like there was any hope. It didn't look like there was any fulfillment of my dream in sight, but I trusted God. I chose to believe him even when I didn't see the fulfillment of that promise. I chose to praise him anyways, because you know what? It's all about loving him and just choosing to love him no matter what our circumstances or our feelings are. But you know what? When you do that, you press through yourself, you press through your feelings, there is fruit on the other side and you will reap a harvest. God is the rewarder. Jehovah Gamola is his name. That's the God who rewards. I heard Marilyn Hickey say that, Jehovah Gamola, the God who rewards. He says when we diligently seek him, he will reward us. And then the last thing I wanted to say was raise. You know, what do you do in between the promise and the fulfillment? You press in, you praise God, and you raise. What that means is Psalm 3:3 says that thou, O Lord, are a shield about me, the glory and the lifter of my head. You know, he doesn't want you, when you're believing for something from him, to have a head bowed down in shame. He doesn't want your head bowed down. He wants to raise you so you can raise others around you. He wants to lift your head so you can lift the head of others that are around you running the same race as you. So I just pray that, you know, my story tonight has just encouraged you, has just, you know, given you fresh hope tonight. You know, I'm walking in that fulfillment of dreams come true at last, and there's life and joy. I'm getting married January 14th. It's just 34 days away. We're getting married at Victory. We're going to go on our honeymoon. We're going to come back here, hug my parents goodbye, and then we are moving to Ireland. And I am so excited. You know, some people have said, how can you, you know, you, Cynthia, you know, you're a little girl from Oklahoma. Like, you know, and I was like, well, you didn't know that I traveled the world when I was a single girl. And I lived in Costa Rica for a year, and I've been to Russia. Did you know I backpacked Europe, you know? And people, you know, they don't know what you've pressed. They don't know, but it's okay. It's okay. I'm just rejoicing anyways. I am so prepared. I have to tell people, you know, when they say, are you scared? No, I am. God's prepared me for 20 years for this moment, for such a time as this. I am more than ready. I am so excited. You know, I've got my honeymoon bag packed, you know, packing things to ship over. It's just like, you know, I am so ready. But I just want to encourage all of you ladies tonight. Thank you so much for letting me speak into your lives. And I just pray that God has just given you fresh hope tonight. I know the ministry time is going to be amazing, but let me just pray a blessing over you. Is that okay? And are there any single girls in here that are believing to be married? Would you just lift your hand if you're waiting for the right one? Okay. Yes. Okay. Okay. Thank you, Jesus. Let's just agree together in prayer tonight. Thank you, Father God. We praise you, Jesus. Father, we praise you, Lord, that you are in this place, God. You are mighty to save. You are the Lord our God in the midst of us, mighty to save. Father, I thank you that you are the God who goes before us and defeats our enemies before us, that you make every crooked place straight in every life here. And Father, I just lift up these women that are believing for the right one, God. I thank you that they are going to get your best, God. I thank you that they are going to enter into their dreams coming true at last, and there's life and joy. We loose the angels even now, God, to divinely connect them to their spouse by your Spirit. Open their spouse's eyes even now. Prepare them even now, God. Surround them with godly friends and godly counsel, God. Do the work that only you can do within each of them. And we just see them coming together by your Spirit. You draw them together by your Spirit, Father. And I just thank you. We just release these ladies that are believing, God. We just release them into fresh hope, fresh grace to run this race, God, to full and complete fulfillment, God, in Jesus' name, God. And I just bless every woman here, God. I thank you that you are a fire before us that devours our enemies, God, that your glory is our rear guard. So nothing holds us back from stepping into everything you've called us to. I thank you that these women are released tonight into their destiny, into fullness, into heart's desires coming to pass, into dreams coming true at last, and there being life and joy. So, Father, we just receive your blessing from heaven, God, and we thank you for your presence in this place. Holy Spirit, we welcome you to have your way in this prayer time. Refresh, heal, and restore, God. We love you, Father, and we praise you. You're so good. Hallelujah, Father. We thank you, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, ladies.